just what every garage needs, loads of junk. So this is a 1954, I think it is. I haven't looked at the paperwork in a while. Rolls Royce Silver Wraith, which was the one that came after the Wraith. World War II got in the way of production. It was a funny time for Rolls as well, because of rationing and everything else. They were only making Phantoms were only issued to people who were dignitaries. But if you were wealthy enough and could feel like it was okay to drive around in a very expensive car, despite the fact the country was recovering still, you could, however, buy one of these. Now, this is a Rolls-Royce Silver Wraith made by Park Ward, and there were effectively a few makers of these are the coach builders that made these lovely aluminium bodies. This has been stripped ready for painting. One was H.J. Mulliner, which is the old one I've got. The other is Park Ward, which was a sort of London based, I think. And then there was Hooper's as well. Personally, I think the Park Ward's and the H.J. Mulliner's are the nicer ones. This was going to be Hooper bodied, I think, but then they changed it and it became a what they call a, I think it's something like a lightweight six or something, six light. And that doesn't mean it's light because it's incredibly heavy, I'm sure. Even though it's got a lot of aluminium, it means it's got six windows because one of them split or something like that. So three and three. Look at the traffic locators. So usual industrial size chassis. And although this is in a pretty bad way, it's actually complete. It was stripped for restoration. So all the engines in there and the gearbox and everything, and it has got a swab for the back seat, but it would need, you know, fairly extensive and expensive renovation. But I just love these handmade cars. So I was able to, I bought it was an old Shadow before they went up. I mean, they're still relatively cheap, but I mean, I didn't pay a lot for it. And a dealer wanted a car he could just put on his forecourt, and my Shadow was in very nice condition. So I swapped it for this. Now done up, this is worth more. But obviously you'd have to have the money, which I don't have. I was hoping I have a bit more than I've got, but that's life, you know, who isn't like that? I'm gonna probably move it on. So if you are interested, get in contact, you know, make me an offer. But it's got the engine, the gearbox and everything, and I've got all the glass for it. And not, you know, I think generally speaking, other than the headlining and things like that and the carpets, and that the back seat squab, and the flying lady, mostly it's complete. You know, I've got all the glass and everything. I've got these side panels and the spats, they're in storage at the moment. But beautiful. And in fact, Rolls-Royce were so sad, I think, that the coach-built folk were really struggling in the end, that they took over H.J. Mulliner and Park Ward later on, when coach building was sort of a dying art, and formed Mulliner Park Ward, who used to make the Cornishes for them. So they kept the skills. Brilliant, typical of that company, really. But this was sent off to, I think it was one of the big merchant banks, Shanghai or something like that, I don't know. But it's got an interesting history and an interesting specification, including lockable fuel filler cap and extra strong sort of in foreign countries suspension was specified for this. And it was obviously sat by the wealthy folk in some merchant bank somewhere across seas. So quite a sort of romantic history in a way, but beautiful. All this was made by hand, people working over English wheels and hitting bits of aluminium with hammers, you know, very much like they used to make aircraft, really. And there's a lot of things with old rollers that just feel a little aircraft like but again, despite the fact it's literally an antique and not had a lot of love, as you can tell, it's still all the fit lines are pretty good. They really were master craftsmen. Just the detail they put into these things was absolutely incredible. So hopefully I'm a wealthy owner, and that won't be me, unfortunately. I'm pretty much resigned the fact that I'm not going to have the sort of money this needs. We'll restore her and be driving along in some leafy lane one day with looking at the flying lady and feeling like $1 million again, hopefully for a lot less than that too. So these are still pretty good value when you think of the work that goes into them. Imagine if you had to have one of these hand built now, it would probably be half a £1 million car in comparison. So Yeah, they're still relatively good value. The old rubber's holding up pretty well too, which is incredible. The chassis, its usual steam engine sort of Victorian size, so there's plenty of life left in the chassis. still an inch thick, I think, in most places, so plenty of wear left. Typical over-engineering. So there you are. That's the that was going to be my 100 subscriber special, but I couldn't get at it. But since getting rid of all the Christmas decks, I've been able to get at it today. So anyway, ta-ra for now.